have all of you here today, and I'm happy to have those of you who tune in and watch online. My name is Shirley Haugen, and we are in the second chapter of Acts today. And this, I think, is a really exciting lesson. Last week, we talked about how the first three chapters of Acts can be described this way. Acts chapter 1, the Savior went up. Chapter 2, the Spirit came down. In chapter 3, the saints went out. So the Savior went up, the Spirit came down, and the saints went out. So today we're on chapter 2, when the Spirit came down. We should have had this lesson, by the way, we should have had this lesson on May 19th, which was the official Sunday of Pentecost for 2024. So we're talking about Pentecost today. And yeah, we're just a little bit behind. We're not doing it on the actual day of Pentecost, but still, it's a really good study that we have today here in chapter two. If you remember last Sunday, we were in chapter one. It was at the end of chapter one, Jesus had ascended to heaven. We talked about how he went to heaven in a cloud. And at that time, after he had ascended, all the apostles and the disciples gathered in an upper room. There was about 120 of them that had gathered. And they, Peter stood up and said, hey, we need to find another apostle to replace Judas. And we talked about how they prayed and then they cast lots and they chose Matthias as their 12th apostle. So today in our story, we have a similar situation. All these 120 some odd disciples are gathered together again, probably even in the same house, in the upper room of probably what was someone's really nice home, a home big enough to accommodate all this, these people that had gathered. And it is the day of Pentecost. It's the Jewish celebration of Shavuot. And Pentecost, the word in the Greek means 50th. It's the 50th day after Passover. So if you had Passover and then you counted 7 weeks of 7 days, then you get to the 50th day, which is Pentecost. And, you know, when you look at all the Jewish celebrations and feasts and festivals that they celebrate, it's difficult to keep up with them because they have different names for them. It's almost like trying to keep up with all the different highways and freeways around Dallas-Fort Worth. You know how they all have multiple names? It's the same way with all their festivals. But it is Pentecost. They're having the celebration of Shavuot. And it's also known as the harvest harvest offering, or the Feast of First Fruits, or the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So it has all these different names. But during this feast or this festival, the Israelites would usually bring a sheaf of wheat, some of their first grains that they had harvested. And then it says in Leviticus 23 that the priest would then take the sheaf and wave it before the Lord. The Passover offering was typically barley, the one that they do earlier in the year. Barley is a lighter grain that ripens more quickly than wheat. And so it was usually given at the Passover. But during this Feast of Weeks, this particular Pentecost gathering, they would usually make their first offering of wheat. So we know that our story took place on Pentecost, this 50th day after the Passover. And so it's no coincidence, if you think about it, that our story took place during the Festival of Weeks, where they gather and bring their first fruits of the harvest, where they bring in their wheat offerings. And we know that the Holy Spirit is about to come down to give his followers, give Jesus' followers this power to go out and do their ministry, to do what he had asked them to do. And you know, you remember when Jesus spoke to the Samaritan woman at the well, at that time, after that had happened, his disciples had rejoined him after he spoke to her. In John 4:35, Jesus said, "Don't you have a saying? It's still 4 months until harvest. I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest." So it's interesting that when they're celebrating the harvest, Jesus is sending out, he sent out his followers to harvest people, harvest souls. Jesus likes to use this phrase as a metaphor for the spiritual harvest. And Jesus compares the work of evangelism to harvesting crops. In Jesus' illustration, the field represents the world and the ripe grain represents people who are ready to receive the good news. And Jesus is telling his disciples that the moment for spiritual reaping has arrived. This is the time. And, you know, even though he was telling his disciples then, this is the time, that time continues. It's continued all these years, even to today and beyond, until Jesus comes again. This is the time of the harvest. And, you know, remember before Jesus ascended into heaven, he told his followers to wait in Jerusalem for the Holy Spirit to come to them, to give them power to be his witnesses. When Jesus went back to heaven, the disciples no longer had Jesus there with them in the flesh. And this was the first time they'd been without Jesus now for like 3.5 years, because that was how long they had, you know, Jesus had been ministering. So they needed the promised Holy Spirit to guide them and to, so that they could go out and tell others about Jesus. So it was kind of like, you know, when parents raise a child, at some point you got to send them out on their own. So he sends them out on their own, but he says, but the promised Holy Spirit is going to come. You know, John the Baptist first told us about the Holy Spirit in the New Testament when he was telling people that he was not the Messiah, but Jesus is the Messiah, the chosen one. John 1 verses 33 and 34 say, and I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one. So John the Baptist baptized with water, but Jesus would baptize with the Holy Spirit. Later at a festival in Jerusalem, Jesus said this in John 7, beginning in verse 38. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. So here we see Jesus referring to the Holy Spirit as a river that flows from us. Ezekiel 47 in the Old Testament also talks about a river. It talks about a water flowing from the temple, a river of life, which mirrors the river of life flowing from the throne of God and from the throne of the Lamb in heaven in Revelation 22. So I love that the Bible uses this imagery of a river and flowing water to represent the Holy Spirit and God's presence. You know, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is Spirit. So we usually can't see Spirit with our human eyes. So sometimes God shows us Spirit in other ways so that we know his Spirit is with us. And we'll be talking about that in our lesson today. So sometimes the Holy Spirit manifests itself in these different ways so that we can see it. Sometimes it manifests as water, sometimes as the wind, and sometimes it manifests as fire. So if you read Acts chapter 2, verse 1, starting in verse 1, it says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So this word Spirit in both Hebrew and in Greek, in the Greek word, it's pneuma, P-N-E-U-M-A, reminds me of pneumonia, has to do with the breath, right? Pneuma translates to wind or breath. So this wind came and it filled this whole house where they were gathered. And although we usually can't see the wind, we can see the effects of the wind. We can see the wind blowing leaves on the trees. And if you're in the house, I'm sure their hair and their clothes were blowing from this wind that was in the house. And it wasn't a gentle breeze. It was a mighty wind. In fact, some translations say it was a violent wind. And we've had a lot of violent wind here lately. We've had storms blowing through. We've seen the results of those high winds all around our neighborhoods with trees down and limbs down. And so that's what was going through this house. So you can imagine this rushing wind going all through the house. So even though we couldn't see the wind, they couldn't see the wind, they certainly knew that something was going on when they felt the wind blowing like that inside the house. So the Holy Spirit manifested as wind, and then something really strange happened. The Spirit manifested as what it describes as tongues of fire. And I can't even imagine what that looks like. There's all kinds of artist renderings of what this might have looked like, but they could visually see some kind of fire that came down and then separated, and these little tongues of fire came on top of every person that was gathered there. And you know, fire all through the Bible represents the Holy Spirit or the presence of God. We know about Moses and his burning bush that wouldn't burn up. And in the tabernacle in the Old Testament, there was a cloud of fire above the tabernacle where God dwelled. In Numbers 9:15, it says, on the day the tabernacle, the tent of the covenant law, was set up, the cloud covered it. From evening till morning, the cloud above the tabernacle looked like fire. So it was a cloud that looked like fire. I think when I read that description, it made me think of like a fiery sunset, you know, where the sun is just burning so bright in the clouds, it almost looks like a fire. So there was some kind of a cloud of fire that would appear above the tabernacle. And then in 1 Corinthians 6:19, it says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. So if you think about it, in the Old Testament, the cloud of fire appeared above the tabernacle, which was God's dwelling place. And now at Pentecost, these little tongues of fire, I say little, I don't know how big they were, little, medium, big, I don't know. These tongues of fire appeared over the people, because the people, the believers, are the dwelling place of God. So we, our bodies are the temples of the Holy Spirit. So I love that comparison. We, our bodies, are the temple of where God dwells. I had to look up something in gotquestions.org because I always love to hear their take on things. And they posed the question, how is the Holy Spirit like a fire? And here's the answer that they give us. Fire is a wonderful picture of the work of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is like a fire in at least three ways. He brings God's presence, God's passion, and God's purity. The Holy Spirit is the presence of God as he indwells the heart of the believer. In the Old Testament, God showed his presence to the Israelites by overspreading the tabernacle with fire. The fiery presence provided light and guidance. In the New Testament, God guides and comforts his children with the Holy Spirit dwelling in our bodies, the tabernacle, and the temple of the living God. The Holy Spirit creates the passion of God in our hearts. After the two traveling disciples talked with the resurrected Jesus, they described their hearts as burning within us. That's from Luke 24. After the apostles received the Spirit at Pentecost, they have a passion that lasts a lifetime and impels them to speak the word of God boldly. The Holy Spirit produces the purity of God in our lives. God's purpose is to purify us, and the Spirit is the agent of our sanctification. As the silversmith uses fire to purge the dross from the precious metal, so God uses the Spirit to remove our sin from us. His fire cleanses and refines. So I like, they always have good explanations of things. So in Acts 2, verse 4, the Holy Spirit manifested itself in yet another way, in the disciples' ability to speak in tongues. It's interesting that the fire is described as tongues of fire, and the Holy Spirit brings with it this ability to speak in tongues. So I didn't know if there was any, I couldn't find any comments on if there was any connection with that, but this gift of being able to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them came upon all the disciples that were gathered there. So if you look at the word manifestation, the definition is to render apparent, to appear, to give evidence of. So the Holy Spirit on this day of Pentecost is manifesting itself in ways to make himself apparent and to give evidence of his being there with them. So the Holy Spirit is showing himself to the disciples, and really not just to the 120 or so disciples that are gathered there, but all the other people that are gathered in Jerusalem for this festival, this feast they're having. When this wind happens and all these people begin speaking in tongues, remember back then they had all their doors and windows open to let air circulate. So all the people gathered around were hearing this commotion going on in this house. And they were wondering what is going on. So the Holy Spirit, when it reveals itself to us through the wind and the fire and the ability to speak in tongues, the people around the disciples were also getting to witness what was going on. So the disciples were able to speak in the languages of the people who would come from all over to attend the Festival of Weeks at Pentecost. And there were people there from all these different countries. They said some were there from as far as Rome who were there for the festival. And all these people spoke all their different native languages. And yet these disciples who'd never studied these languages could now speak in all these other people's languages. So when they talked and they told the story of Jesus, those people visiting in Jerusalem, those Jews who had come, they could hear the story of Jesus in their own native language. It was really a miraculous manifestation of the Holy Spirit to spread the good news. Dave, will you read for us Acts 2, verses 5 through 8?
Sure. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the crowd came together. They were bewildered because each one of them was hearing them speak in his own language. They were amazed and astonished, saying, Why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we each hear them in our own language to which we were born?
There you go. So they're hearing this and they're amazed. And so you remember when Jesus told his disciples to wait for the Holy Spirit so that you can be my witnesses. Now they've received this Holy Spirit. With that, they have this supernatural ability to speak to all these people, all these visitors, tourists, basically. They're basically religious tourists who come to Jerusalem for this faith gathering. And now they're hearing the story of Jesus being spoken. And if you think about it, what better opportunity to spread the gospel? So this Holy Spirit-given ability to speak in tongues allowed Jesus' disciples to really tell the good news. And I think it's interesting because when you read this story about what happened at Pentecost, it really is the antithesis or the reversal of what happened back in the Old Testament at the Tower of Babel. Remember, in Babel, the people came together wanting to build a great city and make a name for themselves, and they wanted to build a tower to the gods, to the heavens. But God thwarted their plan because they were full of pride. They were basically wanting to build their own way to heaven, so to speak. And God was the one who was going to give us the way to heaven, not humans, not with pride, you know. So God thwarted their plan, and he confused their language so that they couldn't communicate and work together to continue building that tower. And so the tower was left in ruins. He scattered the people. He confused their language. And that's what happened. And here at Pentecost, it's almost like we see a reversal of that curse. And I've got to read you this. This is what one of the scholars said. At Babel, there was a spirit of pride. At Pentecost, there was a spirit of love. At Babel, they were divided through language. At Pentecost, they were united through language. At Babel, there was confusion. At Pentecost, there was peace. At Babel, we saw humanity full of themselves. At Pentecost, we saw humanity full of God. At Babel, there was destruction of the tower. At Pentecost, there was the foundation of the church. At Babel, they were scattered to tell of God's anger. At Pentecost, they were scattered to tell of God's love. So I thought that was really good. So this manifestation of the Holy Spirit, this was actually prophesied in the book of Joel in the Old Testament. In Joel 2:28, and that's also, by the way, the same scriptures that Peter is about to preach on. In Joel 2:28, it says, "And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions." So when Joel prophesies this in the Old Testament, we saw that come to pass in the story we're studying today, where the Holy Spirit came down and they were speaking in tongues and telling all the Jewish visitors about Jesus. But I also believe that this will happen again. This prophecy will happen again as we get nearer to the second coming of Jesus. We've talked in here before about how in the Bible, when God makes a promise, when he makes a promise in his word, or he makes some kind of a prophecy of what's going to happen in the future, there's usually two parts to that promise or two parts to that prophecy. There's always a short-term, kind of a near-term fulfillment of that promise that takes place. And then later there's another more long-term fulfillment and a more perfect fulfillment that takes place later. And so I think that's what happened. We saw Joel being fulfilled on this day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came. But I think that that happens again to God's people as we approach the second coming of Jesus.
Surely, if you back up like three verses, it's my favorite verse.
In Joel?
Joel 25, it says, "I will redeem thee. Here's the locusts at even." And I think that it's kind of important that it goes with what you're saying here, because this is how he redeems it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all the years that we waste or that the world has wasted, he's redeeming them right here.
I love it. I love that. That's so true. So as the disciples are here at Pentecost, or they're in this house, the wind has come, the fire is above them, and they're speaking in tongues, and people are hearing the story of Jesus in their own native tongues. The people surrounding the house that were hearing all this, they responded in different ways. Many of them listened in amazement. They couldn't believe they were hearing people speak in their own native tongues. But some of the people made fun of the disciples. In fact, they made fun of them, saying they had too much wine to drink. Can you imagine? It probably they were thinking, "What is wrong with these people?" And when that was going on, that's when Peter stepped up. Peter stepped up and he seized the opportunity to tell the good news, and he starts preaching to them. This is known as Peter's first sermon, his first message. So Peter gets up and he's trying to tell them, "They're not drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning." Peter said, "No, this is a fulfillment of the scriptures written by the prophet Joel, the one that I just read to you." And I love that Peter goes and he uses the Old Testament scriptures. He quotes from the book of Joel, because these Jews that had gathered there for the festival, they should have been familiar with the book of Joel. They should have been familiar with these scriptures. And he goes on to quote Joel 2:32. "And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." And so Peter explains the story of Jesus to them. He says that God proved Jesus by his miracles and his wonders and his signs that he performed. And then Jesus was crucified as part of God's plan to be the sacrificial lamb to cover their sins. And then God raised him from the dead, and he was able, and the disciples were able to say, not only did God raise Jesus from the dead, but they all witnessed it. They all saw Jesus with their own eyes after he had been crucified. And so they were all eyewitnesses who could give testimony that they had seen the resurrected Jesus. And then Peter concluded his speech in verse 36 in Acts 2:36. He says, "Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." And then the people responded. And Dave, will you read that for us too? Read Acts 2. Go ahead and do 37 through 41.
Okay. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brethren, what shall we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promises for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So then, those who had received his word were baptized, and that day they were added about 3,000 souls.
I love that.
That's cool.
So when the people heard the story about Jesus, it says they were cut to the heart or pierced to the heart. And that, if you think about it, that is another manifestation of the Holy Spirit being there with them. Brothers, what shall we do? They were cut to the heart when they realized they had crucified the one who'd come to save them, the Messiah. And so in our story today, we have the Holy Spirit showing up now in wind, in fire, in the ability to speak in tongues, and now in the cutting to the heart. The Holy Spirit piercing the hearts of over 3,000 new believers. So the Holy Spirit convicted them of their sin after hearing Peter's message. And many of them became believers who repented, they were baptized, and they joined the numbers of people that were going to go out and spread the good news of Jesus. These were the people of the early church. And I don't know how many were Gentiles and how many were Jews, but I'm imagining that a lot of that 3,000, most of them were probably early Jewish Christians. And so they all received the Holy Spirit. And just as they received the Holy Spirit, every believer from then until this day, when we come to believe in Jesus, we also receive the Holy Spirit. Just because we don't see fire above our heads doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit isn't with us.
Well, you don't.
I think it'd be amazing if God could give us the visual sign again,
cool,
right?
That'd
so
cool.
We can physically see it. But, you know, the disciples already had the Holy Spirit before this day of Pentecost. And we know that because when Jesus reappeared to the disciples after his resurrection, remember, he breathed on them and he breathed the Holy Spirit into them. So they already had the Holy Spirit. But this time the Holy Spirit comes, it seems to be with more visibility, more power. They have more gifts now that they've been given by the Holy Spirit. But it wasn't that they didn't have it already. Jesus had already given them the Holy Spirit. So just because we don't always speak in tongues and always have fire above our heads doesn't mean we don't have the Holy Spirit. Jesus promises us the Holy Spirit just like he promised his early disciples that. So it's just fascinating that on this day at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit manifested himself in ways that were visible and unmistakable and powerful. And I just love what an amazing way that was to kick off the early church. That this story, the book of Acts, this is about how church started. This is the early church. And I know don't we all long for the Holy Spirit to do that again today? To do something. I mean, can you imagine if we church gathered and a big wind would come through and we would see something like that, something visible? And I mean, it would just be so miraculous to see something like that. And you know, maybe we will see a visible return of the Holy Spirit like that before Jesus comes again. You know, all through history, all through the Bible, God's great desire from Genesis all the way to Revelation, his great desire all through history is to reveal himself to humankind. God, we know, reveals himself to us in his creation and, of course, in his word, in the Bible, in the scriptures. And then ultimately, he reveals himself to us through his son, Jesus. In Genesis, we know we're created in God's image, but when we sinned, we ruined things. We messed things up. God's perfect, you know, Garden of Eden he had for us. But in spite of our sin, all through the Bible, all through history, God chose special people to reveal himself to us in various ways. I mean, we had Noah, who built the ark. We had Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We had Moses in the burning bush. And we had the Israelites, of course, the Israelites had the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night and the cloud of fire that appeared above the tabernacle. And then we have Elijah. And with Elijah, God appears as a still small voice, a small whisper. So God reveals himself to us in all these different ways throughout history. And that's his desire to reveal himself to us and have a relationship with us. But because we are dead in our sin, we can't always see. But God has a plan to show himself to us. Hebrews chapter 1 says, in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through him also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So ultimately, God shows us himself through Jesus. Because of Jesus, we are forgiven and we are reborn. You remember when Jesus was speaking to Nicodemus and he said, you must be born again. And so we've talked in here before about the first and second birth. Well, the first birth is our physical birth, when we were born from a mother. And Jesus says we must be born a second time, a spiritual birth. And that's why evangelicals love to use the term born again. I've been born again. Have you been born again? It's talking about that spiritual rebirth that occurs when we come to know Jesus. And John the Baptist said, I baptize you with water, but Jesus will baptize you with the Spirit. And, you know, when you think about what the Holy Spirit really did for Jesus' disciples at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit enabled his people to speak in strange foreign languages. But it didn't just stop there. Later, the Spirit of God, if you think about it, enabled his people, his early disciples, to speak about Jesus with boldness, even when they were faced with unbelievable opposition. They endured hardships and persecution. They had the ability to perform miracles like Jesus did, to serve the poor, to discern. There were all kinds of things that they were able to do because the Holy Spirit was with them. And we know most of the initial 12 apostles died as martyrs. They died, they paid the ultimate price for spreading the good news of Jesus. And they couldn't have done that without the Holy Spirit inside them to give them the boldness and the courage to do that. So the Holy Spirit at Pentecost isn't just a pass to go to heaven. It is the power to go to the world. It's the power he gives us to go out into the world. So whatever our little corner of the world looks like, the Holy Spirit gives us his power and presence so that we can make a difference in the people that we come into contact with in our little part of the world. The Holy Spirit gives us the power to think about this. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in us to bring the kingdom of God from heaven to earth, wherever we are, wherever we go. We bring the Holy Spirit with us. When you travel, when you go to work, when you meet people randomly, wherever you are, running your errands and all that stuff, we have the power to bring the kingdom of God from heaven to earth and share it with the people around us. And that's really the good news for us today in this story. So maybe a good way to think about the Pentecost is this, and I didn't come up with this, someone else did. Bethlehem was God with us, Calvary was God for us, and Pentecost is God within us. And before I wrap up, there's an aspect of this story that's easy to miss. Peter, in verse 14, Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. At Pentecost, it was Peter who preached, and 3,000 people were saved and baptized. If you think about this, Peter was the one who Jesus said, he said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Peter was not perfect. In fact, he said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." So the man that Jesus said those words to is the one who preached the good news and converted over 3,000 people at Pentecost.
Wouldn't it, Peter, too, did he say, "On this rock I shall build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail"?
That's exactly right. So Peter, even though he faltered, he's also the one who denied times. And if you think about it, one of those times he denied Jesus, it was just to a little girl. Why would you deny Jesus to a little girl? It was a servant girl, even. And he denied Jesus three times.
One thing I love about Peter is, like, at the Last Supper, Jesus tells him, "Satan has asked to sift you like wheat." And he said, this is, I love this. He says, "But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail." And this is part I love. "And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers."
And that's what he does. That's what he does. So I wanted to point that out, that it's Peter, who by most of our standards, we can look at him and say, yeah, he's fallen short many times. But look how God used him. It does. It really does. And that's the whole point in this. You know, there's so many people who feel underqualified to tell people about Jesus, or disqualified. Maybe we've done something where we think it disqualifies us because don't look at my past. Don't look at how I live my life, because I'm not qualified to tell you the good news. But Peter shows us that we can all do this. We don't have to be perfect. That's why I love that Peter is the one who preached to the crowd this day. The kingdom of God, think about this. The kingdom of God is for people who missed the mark. The Spirit regularly empowers those that the world so easily overlooks. And really, I mean, that is kind of the basis of the good news in general. Pentecost is a day to remember that Jesus has not left us on our own. And I love that. You know, the disciples were sad and not sure. They were unsure. Like, what do we do next when Jesus ascended and he left them? They felt that way twice. First, they felt that way after he was crucified. And then when he was resurrected and he came back to them, he ascended to heaven and he left them a second time. So twice Jesus had left them, but he didn't leave them alone. He promised them the Holy Spirit. Y'all, I don't even begin to understand the concept of the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. But all of those persons of God, all three of those persons of God are God. And so when Jesus physically left earth to go back into heaven, this Holy Spirit is like, he's still with us. He is with us in our hearts and our bodies because we have the Holy Spirit. It's all one in some kind of supernatural, miraculous thing that our human brains can't comprehend. So we're not left on our own. We don't have to be scared or worried. From Pentecost up until today, every believer in Jesus is given this Holy Spirit. And so Pentecost is a day to remember that Jesus said, remember, he said this, that the Holy Spirit is like the wind. He blows where he wills. So when it comes to the Holy Spirit, if you think about it, we can't package the Holy Spirit in a box. You can't chase down the Holy Spirit. You can't capture it with a leash. You can't box it up. You can't box up the wind or spirit. And how many times do we try to somehow box up God or box up the Holy Spirit? We try to capture him with our theology or with our good works. We try to limit who he can show up for and in what ways he can appear to people. And so we try to box up God and his Holy Spirit and somehow make sense of him based on our human experiences. And we can't do that. The Holy Spirit is not an idea to be contained, but it is a person to be received. I'll say that again. The Holy Spirit is not an idea to be contained, but a person to be received. Apart from the Holy Spirit, the Christian life isn't just difficult, it's impossible. Without the Holy Spirit, who would believe this stuff? It's the Holy Spirit that convicts us of the truth, of the story of Jesus. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we don't love our enemies or pray for those who persecute us. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we don't live open-handedly with everything God entrusted us with. And so maybe our prayer today isn't just, Holy Spirit, we want more of you. Holy Spirit, fill us. But maybe our prayer should be for us to give more of ourselves to him so that he gets more of us. You know, maybe we need to loosen our grip on the things of this world. You know, like Peter, he had his mind on things of the world and not on things above. Maybe we need to let go of control and not expect explanations for everything. Maybe we need to be okay with not understanding everything. The Holy Spirit, we can't catch him, but we can be caught by him. We can't contain him, but we can be filled with him. We can't tie him down, but we can be released by him. There's freedom there. I don't know if any of you are sailors or want to be sailors, but I love this quote. You can take the ropes off the sails of your life and catch the driving force of his presence. And he is like a wind. Maybe we can do what the disciples were doing then. They were gathering together and waiting. And I think in a way that's kind of where our church is right now. Our church, we have a new pastor, new leadership. We're all opening ourselves up to God's will for our church as a whole. And we are gathering. Every week we gather and we're waiting. We're waiting for the Holy Spirit to show us what's next. I don't know about you guys, but we're not always good about, I know I'm not good about waiting. We're not always good about waiting. Some of us say we want an encounter with God, but our calendars don't always look like that. I'm talking about myself here. Our pace of life does not look like someone who wants to actually hear from God. Are we making time just to gather and wait and hear where the Holy Spirit's going to take us? And what if that's all God wants from us right now, is to wait for him? That's what Jesus asked the disciples to do when he left. He says, wait for my Holy Spirit. And they did. They were waiting for him there in Jerusalem. So what changed on Pentecost? We're about to wrap this up. It wasn't the disciples' qualifications. They were just as flawed before and after Pentecost. But what changed was the power and presence of God's Spirit in and through them. You can't take the Holy Spirit and make him fit your mold, but you can turn your life over to him and be molded and reshaped by him.